oppositional and less creating of fractures. There is a danger in ascribing violence to those others who want religion in the public sphere. The point that I'm making here is this Western style understanding that Christians often adopt, that religion and state and the public world should be separate, often goes into the understanding of extremists and labels an extremist as one who wants faith to be public. We can see how this informs the debates. And I'll just give an example of what I'm addressing here. Before I moved here, I came here in 2007, but I understand that there was a vigorous debate in 2005 about Sharia law here in Ontario. Some Muslim leaders proposed that Sharia law be considered binding in family matters, though not in criminal law. Interestingly, 14 years earlier, in 1991, the province had actually allowed for faith-based arbitration in family matters for other groups. But when Muslim leaders asked for it, there was an outcry. But the media and public discourse highlighted the dangerous threat to Canadian democracy posed by radicalized Taliban-like Islamic practices, especially noting the threat to women. A brochure was produced that you can find online called Behind Closed Doors. I should have had a PowerPoint because then I could show it, because this brochure basically suggests that those other foreign women need our protection. Again, there's the separation of groups as if there isn't dignity and integrity to a way of life different in the Canadian context. Extremism can be found at home was the kind of gesture of this pamphlet. A second more recent example, in England, the Archbishop of Canterbury recently suggested that England might consider adopting Sharia law in family matters, and he was met with similar fierce resistance on the grounds that it would bring England back to the Dark Ages. Never mind the fact that Christian marital law had become a legal fact and had been public, but being hospitable and open to another way of thinking about how faith can be enacted in the public sphere produced a difficult conversation. Christian family law has become practically embedded in Western legal systems, but this fact often gets lost behind the debates. In fact, I would suggest that this kind of misunderstanding that happens, this othering processes, actually contributes to growing radicalism among Muslim communities in European and North American countries. And so it's really important for me in my own work and for us in our communities to begin to suggest there's more at stake here than this oppositional logic. Discussion about politics and Islam must do more than simply dismiss Islam as an extremist-leaning religion, or even claim that Islam is peaceful and that extremists have hijacked it, because there are a variety of ways that Muslims account for their predicaments. And as I said earlier, like Christians and those of other faith traditions, Muslims are diverse and live in many different contexts, just the Sunni Shia, Turkish versus Iranian. There is no single Muslim identity. Paul Heck recently said this in a counter to the public way of dealing with religion by governments. He says, religions aren't objects for zoological classification, but dynamic actors in their own right that have something to say about how life should be lived in public. If this fact is not understood, Christians and Muslims will find themselves at odds with one another. I think of the book published by Samuel Huntington, perhaps you've heard the title, The Clash of Civilizations, which too easily lumps into opposing camps the groups. I think this basic presupposition that I'm naming is at work in many things. In fact, it also is reflected in the dichotomous view of classic Islamic jurisprudence, which splits the world into Dal al-Harb, the countries of war, and the Dar al-Islam, the country of Islam. This, and what I appreciate is Gulen's work as he nuances this to try to avoid such kinds of polarizations. So the first point that I wanted to mention, we must see religion as a public player. Both Christians and Muslims seek to live out life in public realm. So the key is going to be, how do we begin to negotiate this together? Not that religion should be private, just my private affair, so never mind politics, nor completely taking over everybody else's way. There has to be a way to share space beyond polarization. So my second point is titled Building Bridges of Connection. Because the binary and oppositional thinking is illustrated, I think, by a dramatic example, and perhaps you remember this, and I just want to name this because it has produced many misconceptions for Muslims of Christians. Pope Benedict XVI, in a famous speech in 2006, approvingly cited a 15th century Byzantine emperor who accused Islam of being a faith spread by the sword, and noted some of the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad as evil and inhuman. This is perhaps the most prominent Christian leader in the world, the Pope, saying these things. Well, while the lecture only mentions Islam in passing, and is overall a quite erudite attempt to defend religion against relativism, which both Christians and Muslims would want to advocate, damage was done to Christian-Muslim relations. There were riots, there were burnings of churches, and the whole prospect of a peaceful coexistence threatened to become undone. The Pope appeared to be levying a serious critique of Muslims, and many Muslims asked, is this the way the Christian world sees us? And rightfully so, when a leader says this. So the first point has to be, leaders need to be more careful. And as a result, I think the Pope has backpedaled quite a bit in the following years. But subsequent to these remarks, violence ensued, and it appeared, even for a brief time, that some of the violence actually confirmed the Pope's thesis. But more was done. Moderate Muslim leaders stepped in and accepted the Pope's invitation to meet at the Vatican, and the results were positive. On October 19th of 2006, 38 Muslim scholars and chief muftis from numerous countries met in Amman, Jordan, and officially accepted the Pope's apology, signing an open letter delivered to the Vatican, and hoping to have further conversation to avoid prejudice against Islam. Their hope was that the church can help ameliorate Western suspicions of Islam, suspicions that Muslims now had of the intentions of the West. So we can see how suspicions pile upon suspicions, which pile upon suspicions. The Pope's largely successful visit to Turkey did a lot to help quell suspicion in the Muslim world. But this whole debacle regarding the Pope's comments illustrates the absolute necessity for interfaith dialogue in today's precarious global context. Religion is a real player on the scene, motivating behaviors and influencing attitudes. So the second point basically is both political and religious leaders must work together to build bridges of mutuality based upon not suspicion, but mutual respect and understanding. And by countering misunderstandings and persuading people of different faiths to work cooperatively, we can reinforce core values that we might share in order to dwell together in public space peacefully. So given this, it was heartening that the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue later that year sent a letter that appraised Islam positively and offered for further dialogue. And at the end of Ramadan in 2007, a common word was produced. Have you heard of a common word? It's an amazing landmark document that probably began its process due to the Pope's mistakes. But in 2007, 138 Muslim leaders sent an open letter to Christian leaders throughout the world in hopes of promoting Muslim-Christian cooperation. And the document was entitled, A Common Word Between Us and You, and argues that without, quote, and I'm quoting here, without peace and justice between these two religious communities, there can be no meaningful peace in the world, end of quote. This profound gesture opened up opportunities for Christians to then respond in kind. And there have been many responses. A group of theologians at Yale University got together and sent a positive response. Pope Benedict himself in 2007 responded positively. And the Archbishop of Canterbury for the Anglican Church in 2008 responded. Major world leaders were talking in these spiritual traditions. Numerous others now have joined the chorus, and there's a book entitled Muslim-Christian Understanding out now that's quite good that I would recommend that goes through both Muslim and Christian leaders and academics respond to a common word together. It's called Muslim-Christian Understanding. This kind of dialogue starts to show that it's possible to build bridges of cooperation across misunderstandings. But how can this happen when we live in a world where allegations of extremism and suspicion still happen? So with this, I'm going to talk about a third point for a second. The first point was that religion needs to be admitted as a public player. And the second point, that religious leaders and people in religious communities need to be in cooperation with one another. And the problems arise when that doesn't happen. This third point, I'm going to outline several possibilities and speak, of course, from a Christian perspective as a gesture of hospitality, but I think the mutuality that's implicit here will be readily apparent. My point is, first of all, that dialogue must now mean understanding and listening to grievances voiced by each other. Grievances that extend back to the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition. For example, we learn in 1492 that Columbus sailed the ocean blue, but often it's omitted that Ferdinand and Isabella went to war and the Moors, the Muslims in Spain, were kicked out of the country. For centuries in the Iberian Peninsula, Muslims, Christians, and Jews had cooperated and worked together in Spain, but in this particular period, hostility against Jews and Muslims basically wiped out any possibility. So it's this kind of thing, these kinds of grievances, that need to be opened up. For my part, as a Christian theologian, and repentance is in due. Listening to each other, somebody needs to repent in the back room maybe. this kind of listening and hearing